Hi, Julia Osher, Recipes for a Sweet Life. Welcome back, everyone. I've got another of my signature 3D cookies here for you today. This one is relatively elaborate and definitely a showstopper, something you want to do as a centerpiece or a special occasion gift. And it is this lovely blue cookie vase. Yes, this is all cookie. And this is the non-cookie vase that it's roughly, I would say roughly inspired from. I have a vast collection of antique Roseville, which is what this vase is. And I love their beautiful rounded shapes and also their really vibrant colors. So I've tried to draw on a lot of the same rounded shapes and colors, but I've put my own personal spin on it by making the flowers and things that are on the side much more exacting and precise. I am known to be very precise. And so you'll see I've got quite an elaborate set of flowers on the cookie version of the vase. So let's talk about the cookies you'll need for this project. It's basically a 10 cookie project, though I've got slightly more than that on the table. I've got a couple of extras of certain shapes just to show you some design options that you might throw in along the way, and which I might actually use instead of following this one to a T. So first and foremost, you'll need two rounded dome cookies. These are one of my classic contoured cookies made with my gingerbread dough, the link to which will be in the video description. I will show how to make this cookie from start to finish. Then I've got two textured pieces. I'm making great use of textured cookies in this project. I think they, when covered with luster spray, they look almost metallic and create this really heightened, glamorous sort of effect. So these are two textured pieces that will become center medallions on the two sides of the vase. Now, for the little cup or lip that sits on top of the bottle, like so, you have a couple of options here. You only need one or the other. You can do a fully textured dome, or you can do a smooth dome. In either case, you'll also want a textured little ring to sit on top to kind of finish off the upper edge. It will be sitting upright like so. And I'll be showing you how to make one or the other versions of these. You'll notice there's a little hole in the bottom. In some cases, I've cut the hole a little bit bigger. That's kind of nice to have. I'm not going to be rigging any rod through these pieces. This is all freestanding without any internal supports, which I like to do so if someone chomps into the cookie, they're not going to hit a stick. However, I do cut this down a little bit because I find it sits a little flatter and closer to the body when I assemble it. If there's a little hole, it can kind of nestle into. So anywhere from a quarter to a half an inch, any bigger and you'll have more of a hole to cover in the final construction than you might like. Now for the base, the bottom of the vase is constructed of two pieces, and there are a number of different options here. I'm going to show you two. In both options, you'll want a textured piece. Again, I've got a textured round. It's slightly bigger than the one I used on the body here. And that's going to sit on either a plaque with the corners cut off. This is actually a standard cookie cutter shape from a Tico. Or you can go with a longer, wider base. This particular cutter is from Cookie Cutter Kingdom, and I'll have links to all the cutter sources in the video description. So it'll either stack that way or this way. I'll make up my mind as I start putting it together, as I often do. And then last but not least, this vase, or rather urn really, it looks more like an urn with the handles, has two cookie handles. Those are all cookie that have been molded in a Wilton mold. So I'm going to be showing you in the next step how to make some of the unusual parts. These plaque pieces, pretty straightforward standard cookie cutters, so we'll be focusing on the textured elements, the medallions, the rings, and the arms, as well as some of the contoured pieces. So I'm going to start first with showing you how to create the contoured shapes, namely the body and the little cup on top. I have a whole other video about contouring cookie dough, so please check that out if you need more details. I'm working with my gingerbread dough. Any non-spreading dough, relatively non-spreading dough, would work well, and I'm going to be covering how to mix my gingerbread dough and what makes a dough spread or not spread in another video, so stay tuned for that. I like to roll it pretty thin for contoured pieces, maybe 3/16 to an eighth of an inch thick. And because I do have to move it off my silicone baking mat to get it up onto the piece I'm shaping it over, I want to make sure it's always freely moving like so, which it is. And I'm gonna be shaping it over a Pyrex, an oven-proof dish. It's about 4.5 inches at the wide end and 3.25 at the narrow end, and I've got all the dimensions also in the video description. And I'm only gonna be covering it partway, maybe halfway down, so I need about a 4.75-inch cutter to allow it to cover that far. Always something a little bit bigger than the diameter of the piece. I'm just using the container, the bottom part of a container of a nested set of cookie cutters, because I didn't have a cookie cutter that big. And again, one last check to make sure it's free moving. We'll cut out that piece, remove the excess dough, and just lift it onto the Pyrex piece. When baking on Pyrex, I do like to lightly dust it with flour. I almost dust no other surface, but the dough is a little more prone to sticking to Pyrex than to certain other surfaces. Then lift it up, center it over the top. Looking at it from all sides, make sure it's centered roughly before you gently tap it down so it conforms to the bottom of the bowl. Just slip it onto the back side of the pan and bake it as you normally would. This bakes at 375 for about 10 minutes. The key thing when this comes out of the oven, while it's still hot from the oven, is I run my knife blade up under the edge and make sure I can twist this. And then I let it mostly cool on the Pyrex, but not completely. When it's still a little warm, I'll take it off. But if I don't run the knife underneath, it's bound to stick to the Pyrex. Pyrex, again, is a little more sticky than the next mold that we'll be using, which is completely silicone. And this is the mold I've used to create these pieces here. Same basic process, center it on the piece, and then work it down as far as it goes. It's gonna spread a little bit on the mold, so I always like a little bit, because it's probably gonna spread down to about here. I'd like to have a little bit of extra room for it to move. And then I do want that hole in there, so I do cut that actually before baking, like so, and then that pops onto the back side of my cookie sheet and also into the oven for roughly the same amount of time. I'm looking for it to be lightly browned around the edges. Now that covers the two contoured pieces. If you were to do this piece, you would shape it over the same dome, but we would texture it first before we put it over the dome. And I'm gonna show you how to do textured pieces now, so that'll become more obvious. Specifically, we're gonna do these little medallions and also this ring, and then lastly, the handles. Okay, so let me start with the basic medallion. I'd like to start the texturing process by getting my dough roughly in the shape I want it to go. And then I'm going to apply texture to it in various ways. In the case of these medallions and this ring, I'm going to use this mat. This is actually a SugarVeil mat for making edible cake lace, but I'm going to use it instead for creating texture. So I want to pick up this piece and then invert the nice smooth side on the piece that I want to texture, and it's this particular pattern here. Kind of press it in a little bit. And then take my rolling pin. I roll this relatively thin, almost till I can see the texture coming through the back side of the mat, because I just get the best impression that way. And I don't want a big bulky piece on the top of these bases either. So once I've got it where I want it, I'll then invert it onto my silicone mat. The mat peels right away very easily. I'm peeling the mat away, not pulling on the dough. And I believe this size here is what I used for the center, which is about 1.5 inches. Just get overhead over the dough to make sure you're centering it relatively well on the piece, because this has got some symmetry to it, and then cut. I like to remove the dough sometimes before I take the cutter out, just so I don't mess up the edges and taking away the excess dough. And then you've got a nice little medallion piece. Easy. Now for the ring, this ring, again, as a reminder, is going to sit on top of the cup to kind of finish it off. Again, same process with the same mat. We're just going to pick up a different pattern off that mat. So I'm peeling the mat away. I'm not pulling on the dough. Again, centering as best I can. Then I'm going to cut it with another smaller cutter. I think that looks pretty good. And then we'll pick out the inside piece and then take away the outer part as well. The last piece I want to show is how to do the handles, and this is a slightly different process. This particular mold is a Wilton mold, also made out of silicone, and I find with this mat, because it is so deep, it's easiest to bake the pieces in the mold. They'll be more likely to hold their shape if I were to press them in and bake them in the mold and then pop them out. So all I would do in this case, again, not flouring it or greasing it, is press the dough in so it's flush all the way in. And then we'll bake 375, probably not quite 10 minutes because these are really fragile pieces. And then as soon as they come out of the oven, I'll invert the mats and they'll fall right out. So in this step, I want to show how to get icing smoothly on contoured sides. I have a whole other video on this as well. So if you want more detail, do check that out as well. The pieces in this project that are going to get smoothly dipped are the two sides and optionally the little cup for the top. You can either dip that or, as I noted earlier, you can just spray the textured one metallic. But I'm going to give you both options. So doing this is not a piping process. I've found that piping over it and allowing it to drain just doesn't look as good as giving it a headlong submerge into icing. So that's what I mean when I say dipping. And you'll see that in a second. The first step, though, before we dip, is that I like to get the bottom edge as flat as possible. When it comes off the mold, there's a wave to it typically, depending on how the dough is spread. So I will sand it down. If I'm not eating the project and it's purely for show purposes, then a piece of sanding paper will do, and it's also the most expedient way to sand. I just give it a little rotating motion on the sanding paper until it's really nicely flat. So that looks pretty good. If you don't want to use sanding paper, then the tool that's food grade and usable is your microplaner. Just a little harder to get all the way across, but typically this would be the motion. It would take me, it's not harder, it just takes longer to do it evenly. When you're done, just dust off the extra crumbs, and then we're ready to dip. And you also want to do that with the small piece if you're going to be dipping that as well. Now you may notice that the inside of the cup is actually metallic there. I actually spray that after I dip it very carefully, and I'll talk about that a little bit more in the spraying step. I'm just going to show though how to dip the big piece. The big piece is going to be much more challenging to dip than the small piece because it's bigger and it's going to be more prone to getting bubbles in it and just more area. There's just more area that needs to be smooth. So if you can dip a large piece like this, which is again is about 4 to 5 inches across, then you can dip a small piece. For this task, I like to work with royal icing of dipping consistency. So it's very close to my beadwork consistency. It falls relatively rapidly off the spoon, but it just doesn't drain off, because if it drains off too quickly, it's just going to drain off this contoured piece. You want it to have some body. So for every cup of my royal icing glue, I might add a tablespoon or more of water until it's flowing like so. And I stir that water in gradually. We don't want to pick up too many air bubbles, because you're going to pick up a lot more air bubbles dipping than you would by normally flooding a cookie. So the less vigorously I stir it, the fewer air bubbles there will be in the end product. Sometimes I also let the icing sit overnight so some of the bubbles dissipate, which is what I did in this case. We'll see if that helps. You want to make sure the icing's also deep enough that when you plunge this in, it's not going to hit the bottom or come close to the bottom of the container, because that's an area where the icing will not, if it makes contact with the bottom of the container, you'll end up with a big mark in the middle of your cookie. So upside down, in it goes, all the way to the upper edge, and then I'm just going to rotate it out. And there are a few little air bubbles in it now, but hopefully they will either pop themselves, or I'll hit them straight away with my trussing needle. You want to have this handy at all times and pop them before the icing dries. And you'll notice I'm doing this over a cookie sheet, because this does create quite a mess. If I had a bigger bowl, I'd be doing this over the bowl and just capturing the extra icing and reusing it. Then you want to set it to drain. And I don't like to do this on a rack, because if you set it directly on a rack, it's going to get little tracks wherever it hits the rack. So I like to actually suspend it. Here I'm just using a cake ring, and I'm going to set it there until it drains completely. So one last step is it's draining, but before the icing begins to really crust, I like to knock off some of the extra draining part here. Basically, I'm wiping the icing in towards the center of the cookie to knock off the excess. And I'm doing that because it has a tendency to drag down the icing on top, and it can cause kind of an elephant skin approach if it drags the icing too much. And also, it's just less to have to file off later when we file once again to make sure these fit nicely together. And you're going to want to repeat this process, obviously, for the other side as well. And that looks pretty good. I'd set this aside to dry completely. Typically, I do that overnight, but I definitely give it at least a few hours before decorating the outsides. So now we want to take all the pieces that we didn't dip, which is many of them, except for the base parts, which we'll outline in flood later, but all the textured pieces essentially, and we want to take them from naked to shiny. And to do that, I prefer to work with a luster spray, such as PME. This particular brand gives broad, even coverage of luster very, very quickly. It comes in gold, silver, and pearl. We're working with gold here. You can alternatively paint on luster dust, extend them with extract, and paint them on, but I find the coverage to be much more uneven and just a more painstaking process. The only downside with this spray is it goes everywhere. So typically I work under a ventilated hood with more than just this backdrop, but just beware of that. Give it a good shake. To really get the sides of some of the pieces that need the sides covered, I've elevated them on cookie cutters. In fact, I'd probably want to do that with all of them, but I'm just going to give you a sense of how this sprays. So they're all done, nice and shimmery. I also wanted to comment on the other piece. As I mentioned earlier, I wanted to spray the interior of the cup that would sit on the top, the one that I had dipped earlier. And to do that, I just mask off roughly the area that has icing on it once it's completely dry, and then just spray into the interior, kind of create a collar, if you will. And then once it's all sprayed, I can pull this off and I'll have kept the blue icing relatively clear. So now that the blue icing is nicely dried overnight, we want to take it from plain to really jazzy. First by putting down the textured medallion, then doing all the ivory piping work by hand, and then lastly laying the roses to conceal the seam between the medallion and the lines. Before we do any of that, it's important to make sure that the two sides come together in a nice fit. Remember, as I mentioned before, you can get some icing overhang as it drips and dries. We want to make sure that's all filed off. I actually started the process on both of these pieces, and it's the same as what we did before, with one exception. And that's that I would, if I'm going to be using sanding paper and not eating this, I do like to cover it with paper towel and not have my hands directly on it because they can leave fingerprints. And of course, if you're going to be eating it, then use a microplaning tool, again, holding the dome with the paper towel in between. Filing process is just like so, as we did before. And the other thing I've done is I've also marked what I think will be the bottom and what will be the front piece of my vase. And I usually choose the bottom so that if there are any imperfections, like that little dent, it's facing down and is going to be less likely to be seen in the final construction because it'll be shadowed. So that's going to be my down, marked by that dash. Similarly, I marked a bottom on this piece, so when I match the bottoms up, there should be a pretty nice fit. So with those prepped and in place, I'm going to start the detail work on the front, and of course you'll want to repeat the exact same process on the back side of the vase. So my first step is anchoring the medallion. Typically, I like to start with large pieces when I'm decorating something and graduate to the smaller, more detailed pieces. So I'm looking at it from overhead. You could measure it out and make sure it's exactly dead center, but I'm not going to be that fussy. I'm just going to eyeball it and stick it down with thick royal icing glue. Again, the thicker the icing is, the faster it'll dry. And I'm using white here just because if I have to shift it around and a little bit ends up showing on the blue, it's easier for me to clean off than any other tinted color. So we're going to leave it like that. And now we're going to start in on the piping of the lines. And basically the process will be, I'm going to start by piping opposing lines, breaking this up into quadrants, then bisecting those quadrants, and then bisecting them once again. So I have 16 lines going down, and then I'll come back and detail every other line with a little bit more icing so we create a frilly, heavier line in between the thin lines. And I'm just going to start by piping the first line, trying to just kind of letting it drop as straight as possible. Occasionally I'll get up and make sure that everything's looking straight from overhead. And we're going to continue all the way around until I get 16 lines down. Okay, with those 16 lines down, I'm ready now to dress out every other line. I'm going to try to create this kind of braided effect, if you will, on each side. So I'm piping on either side of every other line. And to show you the basic motion, push forward, pull back, push forward, pull back. And I'm going to do this on both sides of the line. Just note, my tip is barely open. It might be the equivalent of maybe a number one or a zero opening. So quite fine work we're piping here. I'm going to continue on and do the remaining five lines exact same way, and then we'll start putting roses on this piece. So let's talk about the roses to go around the disc. I have a whole other video that talks about how to make classic royal icing roses, so I refer you to that. I am working with ones, however, that were largely done in pale pink icing with a 101 tip. A 101S tip will create ones that are about a quarter of an inch across. These are maybe half an inch across, just to give you some perspective. But I've created a wide range of texture and appearance to these roses by applying different finishes to them. So I started with pale pink. Then I started spraying some with the gold PME luster spray that we used earlier, just very lightly. These two here. And then still others, I sprayed a little bit more heavily and then dusted the centers with a little bit of brown luster dust. And that creates a little bit of extra depth. So I like to have a wide range of textures going into the application of the flowers so that I get more interest in my bouquet using the same underlying color of icing. So I'm just going to start by anchoring down the roses. Again, using white icing, I'm covering a little bit of the edge of the medallion, but not much. And I'm going to mix up roses of different shades and also some little buds I've got as well. So we've got some interest to the bouquet. And we'll go around like so. Occasionally looking at it from top down to make sure it's nicely balanced. It doesn't have to be perfectly symmetrical at this point because we will be evening it out with the application of leaves in a second. Okay, so now we're going to fill in with leaves to close up any gaps that we see around the roses and to conceal any of the white icing glue. Because this is a relatively dainty piece, I'm using a relatively small number 349 leaf tip. And a relatively thick icing because you want it to hold its shape. So that looks beautiful. Now we want to let this dry completely, again, ideally overnight. So plan other activities around this project because there is a lot of drying time. We're going to, of course, do that to the other side, but both sides need to be completely dry because we're going to be sandwiching them back to back in the assembly process in the next step. Okay, so my pieces are now completely dry, both my back and my front. I like to choose a back and a front. Generally, the piece that I'm least pleased with will go on the back, or the piece that's somewhat smaller so that the bigger piece, if there is one, is facing forward. So I've relegated this my back, and you'll see I've also noted the bottom line as roughly right here. This is my little marking point. And I very gingerly put that upside down on bubble wrap. That way I won't mess up the decorations that I painstakingly piped in the earlier step. And we're just going to be sandwiching these together. This is my 3D sandwiching technique where I basically apply glue and just stick things together. It's as straightforward as that. And once again, I'm going to use a little bit of white glue. Blue would be fine here too because we will be filling the seam a little bit later with blue if there are any gaps. And hopefully my eyeballing technique of bisecting quadrants will allow these things to line up pretty darn well, the lines from top to bottom. And I'm liking what I see. I just want to, before it dries, I want to shift it around so it looks nice from all orientations. So coming around here, everything's fairly well aligned except for this zone right here. I'm not too worried about that because I've got handles to put on the side and they're going to come almost midway down. So I think that to a large extent might be concealed. We'll also be putting a border there which will hide a little bit of that. Now what I want to do, this is actually a fairly small gap, but nonetheless, I want to pipe a border there. And in order to lay a flat border there nice and neatly, I want to fill up that gap so that it's full up with blue icing so that the border lies flat. It'll also act as additional glue. I'm just going to proceed by taking a matching blue color. This is my dipping color, but thickened up a touch. by adding powdered sugar to it to fill this seam. So I'm filling and then wiping it smooth with my finger, trying to keep it off the lines that I piped earlier. Okay, so I think I'm ready to put the dots down. So I'm on to detail work, so I'm back to the heavy duty specs. Because my blue icing between the seams is relatively thick, I don't have to wait too long for it to dry before I lay another color on top. There will be no risk of bleeding because now, by the time I've come around to the starting point, this icing is relatively dry. I'm gonna use light pink icing to coordinate with the pink roses here for the seam. And again, I'm working with beadwork icing that forms a nice rounded bead on its own. And I'm gonna pipe the first few dots relatively big. I like to start in the area of the border with the biggest gap so that I'm sure that the dots will conceal the biggest area, the biggest part of the seam that I have, rather than starting in this tiny area and then finding that the tiny dots don't fill the bigger area later. So these are relatively big. Typically, I'd go all the way around and do this middle line and then come back and pipe dots to create a little triangle effect in each of these little areas and go all the way around with each level of dots. But I'm going to work on a quadrant here just to give you the general idea and then finish this off at my leisure because this may take a little while. So I've finished one quadrant. And again, normally I'd go all the way around to give them adequate drying time before putting dots in between. But I want to show you how I build up this little triangular effect. You could just leave a simple seam like this, but I like a lot of detail. And I've done the same sort of seam on the bottle that you see up front and on another tan one that you could see circulating overhead. So my next step is to come in with three dots roughly in the center here to create the base of a triangle. So right in between the other two, the other staggering the dots, if you will. Now you do want to allow these a little time to crust because if you pipe them too close, the wet dots will merge into each other and become indistinct, and I don't want that to happen either. So if I were to pipe all the way around, I'd certainly be assured of that happening. So I've got the base of the triangle started. Gonna just let these guys crust a little bit, then I want to come back in, do two more dots. But I'm gonna move ahead, piping them maybe a little further apart than I usually do to keep them from blending into each other. So that's the basic process of finishing off the seam. Of course, you could just do a single row of dots, but I'm gonna continue all the way around creating the single row of dots plus the triangles, let that dry about a half an hour, flip it over, and then pipe a corresponding matching little triangle underneath each of these. It's just much more easy for me to do that when the piece is flipped over. Then we're gonna let it dry a few hours till there's no movement between these sandwich pieces. The dots are all dry and we'll begin the assembly process. So our piece here has been drying for several hours. You might notice I marked a little blue tape down here. That's just to mark what I think will be the bottom of the piece so I don't forget. While that's finishing up drying, I do want to move forward and talk about how to decorate and assemble both the base for the urn and also different potential cups or lips to go on top. I'm going to basically try to replicate this guy here. Though I may end up using a different base. I sort of like this longer base that uses a different plaque. But the piping concepts are exactly the same. And they're very similar to the concepts used on the body itself. So I'm going to start again with that ivory icing we used for the line work on the body. I'm going to pipe some simple lines here radiating from the center to the corners using my outlining icing, which is relatively thick and holds a nice tight line. I want to move kind of slowly so I don't break the line. And I think three lines is plenty. I'd like to pipe these first and then place the disc that we gilded on top of it so that the icing in the center acts as glue. Now, while that icing is still wet, I might put another bigger blob in the center for more security. I want to drop this piece right overhead. Press it in, but don't move it too much because we don't want to wreck those lines we just piped. Now I'm going to come back in and use that beaded effect that we used to create the braided effect on the sides. So I'm going to apply it to the outer lines here. So pushing forward, pulling back. So that's basically done, except now for the dots. And these little beaded borders are a little more delicate. Simply the difference is that this tip was probably open up a little bit further. Okay, and so now we're going to return to beadwork icing, the pink dots that we used for the border, the seam rather, on the body. I'm going to use some accents of it down on the base as well, again to tie the piece together. Now let's talk about the various cups that you could have on top. You'll notice the one up here and in the photo flying overhead has actual lines and stripes on it, as well as dots around the upper edge. So I basically did the same process as what I did on the sides of the body. I inverted my blue dome and piped lines down the sides, bisecting different quadrants as I went. So something like this with my ivory icing. And I'm not going to do this whole piece because I think you have the basic idea, but I just did simple lines. I actually didn't do the little scallopy work on it as well, just straight lines. Now, as far as decorating the top, if you're going to go with a dipped piece that has lines on it, you're going to see the icing and the cookie, and it's going to look kind of rough. And that's why we cut these rings earlier for these dip pieces, to cover it up and conceal it, make it look a little bit neater. So that being said, I'm going to glue that down, and I may just use the same thick outlining icing because it's almost gold in color, and stick that on top. And then you want to clean up any glue that's showing before it sets. Now you could additionally trim this out with dots on the inside or on the outer edge, as I've done here. Or you could flip it over and trim out with dots on the under edge as well, particularly if there's a gap between the little ring and the side, because that gap will show when this is ultimately elevated. So that's a method for actually decorating one of the domes if you've dipped it. If you haven't, the decorating process is a lot simpler. Here's just one of the embossed cups that we did earlier. And I just put a few little dots on the top edge. I think I'm actually going to use this one or one with pink dots in the final construction. This is the fun slash scary part when we put it all together. So I've got my base now completely dry so that the disc isn't moving around on top. And I'm going to start by securing the body to it. Again, I'm not using any stakes. I try not to. I suppose you could run a stake through a hole if you had cut a hole in the center, but then you would have had to run the same skewer through the body. That helps a little bit, but the assembly process is still kind of precarious. My trick is to work on a big piece of styrofoam so that I can use these skewers as props, and I also have room to rest bottles up against it to prop it as needed. And my other trick is I'm going to use a little ball of fondant at the base to kind of nestle it into. We don't want too much because we don't want to see it at the end of the day. Then we're going to put a little white glue on top. White is always easier to clean off. And then you want to plunge it in. And there's not a lot of glue there, but it will eventually dry if we prop it in place. I'm going to do that with these two heavy-duty bottles. We just want to make sure before we leave it to dry that it's not leaning forward or backward. Now, at this point, I'd let it sit at least a half an hour until it was more steady and I was able to pick it up. But since we're on video time, I'm going to move ahead and try to put on both the cup and at least one handle that I've got access to. This one's going to be a little hard to get to, but this will give you a full idea of the assembly process. I think I'm going to use the cup with the little pink dots because it ties into my border a little bit better. But it's got a bigger hole, which you'll see. So I do need to, and you'll see some light poking out underneath it. So I want to cover this little bottom area completely with blue fondant. That'll also give it something kind of a little bed or nest, if you will, to stick it down with, much the same way we did at the bottom. So I rolled a little fondant on my pasta machine to the number 3 setting, maybe a 1/16 of an inch thick. I think I'm going to stick it down with a little bit of corn syrup. Not much. So to glue it on, just a little dot of icing on the top, and we will press it on down, but only so much as to keep it level. And again, you want to cut the fondant as small as possible. I have a little bit peeking out here, but I'm going to conceal that maybe in the end with a little flower and a rose, much as I did on the vase up there and that you see scrolling by on the screen. Again, I would give that a little bit of drying time. Check it from all angles to make sure it's level before I set it aside to dry. And I think that looks pretty good. Okay, so it's still drying, which is why I've still got it propped, but I'm going to try to move forward and put the handles on, at least one of them. I like to do the handles one at a time, let one completely dry, and then do the other, just because any slight motion of the container can cause the handles to knock off. They're just going to go on with the very smallest dab of royal icing so that you don't see it. And remember, the handles are those molded pieces that using the Wilton Baroque mold earlier that we sprayed gold. So they're just pure cookie. And I like to situate them such that the bottom edge rests on one of the dots I piped earlier. So probably right about here, and that'll keep it from sliding down. If you can see that I think that'll be kind of a catch down there. We'll see. I will also use my skewers if necessary to prop them until they're dry. So very little icing because I don't want to see it. And I'm using white so that if I misplace it, I have the opportunity to rearrange a little bit better. Okay, so I've got it up and I didn't even need a prop to get it in the right place, but I do want to clean the glue out that's showing. There's a fair bit from the front while it's wet, otherwise it'll dry on, but be very careful. So I've checked it from this side and it's not leaning forward or back, and it also looks really great from the front. So I'm not going to mess with it too much more for fear of knocking it off. It's very delicate right now. I'm just going to rotate it towards you. Then we're going to let that one completely dry, and I would similarly put on the other one. So she's still not quite dry enough for me to add the other handle, but that's quite all right. I encourage you with this project to take your time with it. The key really is adequate drying time between each step. You can go off and do other stuff and come back and pick up where you left off. And if you do that and have patience, it'll come out just beautifully. It's a gorgeous Easter keepsake centerpiece for your Easter table or for any other special occasion for that matter. And in a couple of weeks, I have another great keepsake box coming up for Mother's Day. So till then, stay tuned and live sweetly.